Look at the blind bands. Tempest Parasite coming out from Dominion of Pain. Parasite Cthulhu Font.
First ever blind band Cthulhu Font. I've never seen that.
That's some
ever
respect
in my life.
Right there.
Yeah. And then the blind or the bands coming. The Locks coming out. I expected that actually right away. I was going to say, if they're a smart team, they're going to lock up both Keeper and Wild Soul. Like, that is not a very smart thing to do. If you have a good idea of Ophelia, but you only get one of those three. And with Parasite and Tempest both banned as well,
yeah.
It's not like you can go like two and two. Like, we get two and then you get two. Nope. Now you get one, they get two. As far as, you know, both very strong heroes to both jungle and or suicide.
Mm-hmm.
So say DWI or it's that tag. They actually have three people tagged up as DWI.
So it's like you might as well call them that, right? Yeah.
So say Domain of Pain, say they want Keeper. They first pick Keeper. Well, now you have Ophelia Wild Soul on the Hellborn team. Say they want Wild Soul. Well, now you have Ophelia and Keeper. So, you know, I could go on. There's only three options right there. But, yeah, you get my point, right? Like, that's not a good position to be in already early on in this drafting phase.
Yeah, you know, so maybe, you know, locking up something like a War Beast here for Domain of Pain could be a valuable option.
Of course, right, even Legionnaire too.
Yeah, or Legionnaire for that matter. But he is going to go with Rally Bubbles actually. So Rally, now I have heard Rally has kind of dabbled here and there. And speaking of the in-house league, it seems like he's been also played in that. Of course, TDM I know has used him before as amongst maybe a couple other teams. So not the strangest lock, I guess, but definitely different here. Excited to see if we get some Rally play, but then Bubbles on top of that. You know, again, he only picked 4 to 6 heroes ultimately, so. Might not end up seeing the Rally in the end, but
I would have picked. I think Bubbles lock here is fine, but I would have picked something totally worthless, like Bubbles plus Raw or something like that, because those heroes simply aren't going to get picked. Like Wild Soul, Ophelia, Keeper, those will be gone in the first three picks, guaranteed. So anything, just pick one hero that you know you want to take, and then take something else that is just terrible. Don't give Hellborn team any more options.
Don't give them an out. Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, the Bubbles, they're probably going to pick Bubbles as their last pick out of the lockpick pool. Lockpick pool. And I think that's okay. I would have maybe preferred to see Plague, because you can assume maybe that Hellborn team is not going to pick Plague, and then having Plague. Well, then again, if you don't go Keeper, Plague might not be that strong. Same thing goes with Plague against Ophelia. So now that I'm thinking about it, maybe Plague wouldn't be the best. But either way, I still think that the Man of Pain have kind of set themselves in a little bit of a trap. But we'll do have to wait and see. Obviously, it's still very early on. And the bans have begun. Last lock, by the way, is Alonia, but the bans Glacius, Jirazaya, and then Flux over on Domain of Pain.
Yeah, the Flux definitely standing out right there. I mean, again, it's only able to do just so much research. Either Emperor knows something here as far as perhaps a strategy coming out from Sozo, maybe watch recent replays for them and saw that that they were running some Flux lately, perhaps, but banning of the Flux, and it's almost as if a Formless right there is like, wait, what? I don't know if that's a Yukatus or it's just a... what is that all about reaction? But anyways, Engineer going to be the follow-up game. Going back to the Alonia lock, though, I mean, that kind of goes off what you're saying with the Amun-Ra possibility. Yeah. Just really, you know that really there's 4 to 6 that are able to be picked up. You pretty much can guarantee that it's going to be Ophelia, Keeper, Wild Soul, and then very likely the Bubbles in the end. So yeah, just don't give, in this case now, Domain of Pain out, honestly. So another option. That's a better way to put it. So, anyways, Dracona is going to be the last ban for Emperor. Now back over here to Dr. Kroos. That's what I'm going to call him. Dr. Kroos for the final ban. And then, of course, into the first pick we go. But, yeah, still looking back at that blind ban Cthulhu font. And, again, Emperor loves to run Cthulhu font. That is no secret by now. He still runs it quite often, from my understanding. But from what we have seen, I mean, it doesn't necessarily always work out. There is a lot of criticism surrounding that, you know, whether that is the most effective pick. And it seems like it's kind of been a back and forth on that. But Sozo just, they don't want to deal with it, obviously. So
right.
They did find it worthy to use a blind ban. Nymphora is actually going to be the final ban. And in both teams actually using a bit of extra time there. So not afraid to take advantage of that. We'll see what Emperor decides is valuable to first pick here now.
Yeah, first pick, there's tons of stuff. I mean, you can go with a lot of different things. You just go with Alunia because Glacius is banned and Forest is also banned. So I like that pick. And then, of course, if they do run a Keeper of the Forest, like say the Domain of Pain has in their mind that they want Wild Soul first or Ophelia first, obviously having the counter push available with the power throw from Alunia is a strong tool. So that's a fine first pick.
Yeah, I am curious also about the banning stage. The more I'm looking at now, with that Aluna first pick, not so obviously Glacius was originally banned by Emperor, but then Engineer and Nymphora were the final two bans from Sozo, and so they kind of, you know, almost screwed themselves even in getting a solid support option with those couple of final bans there. So,
well, Torturer is still there, and true. I still think that Torturer is a very, very strong support hero. Wow, Pebbles, Moon Queen, that combination is pretty damn strong, to be honest. Mm-hmm. It's basically Pebbles plus any hard carry, because Pebbles is going to, if you give him a lot of space early on and help him out a ton to give that really, really fast portal key, he in turn will give space to the hard carrying team, and Moon, that these two, the combination of these two heroes is very, very strong. So,
yeah.
But you are right. Like, as far as having hard, strong support, I still think Torture is there. We'll have to wait and see if they agree with me, if they think that is also a viable pick for them this game.
Ooh, there's the Gravekeeper pickup over here, coming out from our Legion side. Now, I know both Jeppins and Cheese Helmet actually play a pretty solid Gravekeeper, so. And I remember you actually talking about it the other day. I mean, the Gravekeeper, especially with that ultimate. That ultimate provides a lot of damage, actually, if you use it appropriate. So excited to see some Gravekeeper play. And then Zephyr actually going to be picked up as well over here for Domain of Pain. So their regular picking stage is done, and definitely a little bit of a curveball there. But overall, looking to be a pretty solid lineup from what I can see here, Trev.
Yeah, I like Zephyr. That tells me they're going to definitely take Ophelia first out of that lockpick pool. And that the combination of those two heroes is also very strong together as well, because obviously I talk about it all the time. Zephyr being able to consume those tornadoes for extra health, and on top of that, having double heal from Ophelia, meaning both her ultimate and an Astrolabe, which she'll most likely pick up relatively fast, is very, very difficult to, you know, combat that kind of push early on.
Yeah.
Especially when you have a Moon Queen and a Pebbles on your team. So, something right here, I think Torture is like optimal pick right here. Perhaps maybe a support Pyro. Like, Pyro Pebbles is also a very, very strong lane. We don't see it too often, but it is very strong. Ooh, I hate this pickup right here. Prophet has very, very little to offer as far as counter push goes. And when you see a Zephyr and then lots of push available in the lockpick pool, it should be a snap pick Ophelia here. Yeah. Then Prophet is just going to get run over, I feel. So I do not like that pickup.
Yeah, I mean, the lockpicking stage pretty much going to go as expected. The Ophelia snap pick, the Keeper of the Forest, while it's a response. Now, the final pick, I would assume it would actually be the Bubbles, but Emperor is actually thinking about it a little bit. They are swapping around heroes, so maybe that's what's taken away from it. But at least putting some thought into this, using that extra time, perhaps, to just want to make sure of what they go with. But, yeah, so you're making the point, Prophet, not necessarily a huge fan of that support option. You get, you know, your Torture, your Pyromancer even. The creep clearing potential, I think, is the point that you're really trying to bring up and stress. And Prophet ultimately doesn't have that great of creep clearing potential. So what do you think about his synergy with, say, a Pebbles at least in the laning phase?
I mean, in the laning phase, it's not bad at all. Like, in fact, it has a ton of burst damage. And they do go with the Bubbles, of course. It's just a matter of if Domain of Pain places correctly, and like you just farm up on Ophelia very, very fast. Like, you get a level 5. You don't even really try to gank because it's not necessary.
Yeah.
But you don't really try to gank. You just farm up to level 5, and then you just start pushing a Zephyr. You get one tower. Maybe you get two. Zephyr gets an early, early Helm of the Black Legion, and then you just transition to start pub training, basically. Like, you just all sit as 5, take all their towers, and it's very, very difficult for a team against that to combat that.
Yeah.
Basically, the only thing they can do is dodge fights and counter push. But I don't think that you're going to be able to counterpush that quickly with the heroes you have against this this Legion lineup. So, yes, in the laning phase, Prophet will be strong. But once it starts to get in out of that laning phase and transition into like the push lineup that Legion team has, I don't think that Prophet's going to be that effective.
Yeah, I mean, it's one thing to keep in mind the Ophelia and the Zephyr especially, but then you really have to keep in mind the Gravekeeper again as well. His ultimate is actually not only good for just doing a lot of damage in team fights, but pushing towers, it's crazy. I mean, it'll really assist in pushing towers as well if that's what he finds it necessary to use for. So Cheese Helmet is going to be the one playing the Gravekeeper. He's actually using a skin I haven't seen before. I'm guessing this is one of his new skin, so again, always it seems like every single game we have lately on Honkast there's a new skin.
Yep.
There really is just so many skins in this game, so which is a good thing. I mean, it definitely helps with diversity. Moon Queen is actually also using that badass skin that we seem to both like. But yeah, obviously vote to pause here to start things off. But now the laning phase, it does seem fairly obvious what we should expect to see, honestly, from both sides. I mean, well, Zephyr is getting, he got pulled up regen. He got pulled up a Rune of the Blight. So I guess Parakletos is going to be heading bottom on Zephyr. And so should we expect to see something like an Aluna Gravekeeper move?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And that will be mid. And the only thing about that is Zephyr versus what might be, I don't know who it's going to be. Well, with the items that Wild Soul has, that kind of tells me it is going to be a Suicide Wild Soul and then Keeper in the jungle. And Wild Soul can actually do well against Zephyr. Like, if you get a couple of lucky Entangle procs early on, right when you hit level 3, that does a lot of damage. And so that extra region that Paracletus got pulled is very, very necessary. So I'm interested to see how that lane sets up. And especially with this team, I feel like you just want to babysit your Zephyr. Because what else do you have to offer in the mid to late game against, you know, Pebbles, Moon Queen, Keeper of the Forest, Wild Soul? Like, your late game is not even close to their level. So babying the hero that you'd think needs to have the most farm, I think, is the right way to go. Not the Gravekeeper.
Well, that's actually what kind of threw me off, because what I expected was to see a short lane Gravekeeper with a Illuna Zephyr mid. So would you say it either do that or just have Illuna go bottom with Zephyr even?
I thought initially that, you know, Illuna could go bot with Zephyr. And, you know, with an Ophelia, it's always important, too, to remember that you can man up long lane, which is what they might do and just send bubbles mid. And actually looking at Jeppin's items, he is going to be going mid. So this will be a manned up tri-lane. Against what's presumably going to be a Moon Queen solo, but you can safely assume that you're going to see some response come out from someone. Like maybe a Prophet will come, you know, top to help out Moon Queen, or maybe they just might even switch it up to go Pebbles, Prophet, top. But against a pseudo tri-lane with Ophelia, that can be a little risky. And you do have dual range between Gravekeeper and Luna, so I actually do like this decision by Domain of Pain. But again, you're on a very fine line. It's a very thin line at that. And if you screw up at all, like, you do not have the late game. So a lineup like this, it's fine, but it's very scary, because if you do screw up, that's basically your last chance, your only chance.
Yeah, you're no doubt about the, not necessarily early aggression in ganks, which they definitely have potential for, but I think push is the ultimate thing. You know, grouping up and push eventually earlier on in this game, it seems like it's going to be a valuable strategy here for Domain of Pain to kind of work with. So, yeah, Zephyr, he definitely got pulled. Not only did he get the Tangos or the Rids of the Blight, but he also got a health potion on top of that pool to him. So, yeah, plenty of regen he has to work with there at the bottom lane. And sure enough, that pseudo-aggressive trial lane is going to be ran here. So we'll start off with Bubbles mid versus a Pebbles right now. You do have Prophet is here. And actually, Moon Queen seems a little bit lost almost. Very curious what decision Moon Queen's trying to go for here. Is she going to actually come mid in the end? Is that what's going to happen here? I'm not sure.
I don't know. Yeah,
they seem confused.
They don't exactly know what to do either. And the supporting Moon Queen mid?
Is that what just happened?
Or she's actually trying to take CS. This is very, very awkward.
Yeah.
Now, the solo Prophet top. What is going on here?
That miscommunication or something. I don't know.
Okay,
she
just keeps running back and forth.
Yeah. I could see it being a natural.
Look, there she goes again. She ran.
I would be so curious to see what their Skype is like, whatever they use. I mean, because clearly there is mass confusion over here. She's going to run into Ophelia, actually, and now she's going to start running back again. It's almost as if she's on patrol here, going back and forth. So. But my point was going to be that, especially, you know, with a team that's perhaps less experienced, you know, they get intimidated by the fact that, well, our Moon Queen is going basically a one, like, in a sense, kind of a one versus three with an aggressive Ophelia up there. So we want to actually switch her up and center mid, it looks like that's going to be the case in the end.
Well, Grabs, you got Bubbles level 3, now she's going to be crushed by a solo
hero,
which is even worse.
Yeah.
Like, this is just horrible decision making.
Because now your Pebbles is not going to get farmed.
Now the hero that you need the most farm out of anybody on your team, at least early on, is going to have nothing. And is now going to a suicide lane, basically, against three with an Ophelia, who did a really good job, actually, by the way. He double-stacked a camp here, the medium camp, and just killed him very, very quickly with the Vulture Lord. Not just the Vulture Lord attacking, but using the spell of the Tornado, which was much more effective than just auto-attacking it down. And so Ophelia got extra levels right there. He's going to kill this camp and then have a Minotaur. This could be easy first blood up here in the top lane. And like I said, now you have a Moon Queen who got gimped a little bit early on, because now she's up against a Bubbles who's level 3, probably almost level 4, and Bubbles already has a better time in this matchup.
Yeah, I'm really uncertain what Sozo was ultimately thinking there. We do see the Minotaur is going to be coming in, though, as expected. Trying to set up a gank on a Prophet, but the what was that ability called? The Persecution was applied and helping save him, so...
Well, and Emperor kind of juked himself right there. Like, he couldn't decide which target he wanted to go to, and then just kind of went in the middle. And again, it's indecision like that. You just got to go for something.
Yeah.
Either go all out on the Prophet, which would have been the smarter move, and just, you know, understand that your team, you can rely on them to come out and follow up. And there was just that was a very, very easy kill that they missed out on. But it doesn't really matter because look at where the lane position is. Like,
yeah.
These two can't do anything. This Profit and this Pebbles, that is.
Yeah, so again, it's you really... The decision-making here early on from Sozo, unfortunately, just not the greatest for the laning phase. We are going to have a vote to pause again here, coming out from Domain of Pain, but apparently his screen is black. I don't know if that means his monitor is actually out or his game maybe just got bugged. But anyways, yeah, it seemed like that actually was going to be an easy blow. Let's go, I agree. They were pretty far pushed up, and you had that Minotaur right next to the lane, so... But just unfortunate for Emperor, wasn't able to actually line it up correctly. So still no Bloodlust kill. Again, that's at least some good news for Sozo. All across the board, it just doesn't seem like Sozo is having the greatest start here now. 3 minutes into this game, so still very early on, of course. But even this early on, this goes back, you know, we're talking so much, or you were mentioning for Domain of Pain. Again, they built a team, especially when you compare it to the Hellborn side, that it's more of an early, especially eventually into that mid-game stage of aggression and ultimately winning with that. Now, on the other side of the spectrum, you can look at it for this Hellborn team. They need to make sure not to let that get out of hand early on, or else it will just completely snowball. And this could be a quicker game as a result. So, and that's kind of, again, we're so early on, only 4 minutes in now, but... If they're not careful, it could start to get that way. So,
yeah.
Even despite no kills even happening just yet. But how's Zephyr doing down here? Zephyr's 17-5 compared to a 14-0 keeper. And actually, Pebbles and Prophet are now down here. So a lot of just complete change-ups going on. Wild Soul has actually made his way all the way to the top lane. So losing a lot of experience, though.
This is just absolutely terrible decision-making. And Zephyr now has enough for his B-start if he wants, so he can bring that down here. And he can once he gets that, he can basically 2v1 them because he's got so... Look at him. He's level 5, probably almost level 6 against a level now just hit 2 Prophet. Mm-hmm. Top lane, we still see some aggression now onto Wild Soul, who's transitioned up here. And not to say that Wild Soul was really doing well bottom, but this is... I don't know. This is just not going to work out. Keeper of the Forest, you forget that he is on the team as well. He was jungling, and hopefully he can hit level 6 soon to rectify the problems, the big problems that the Hellborn team is having.
Yeah. Well, if anything, you know, get level 6, get your Ring of Sorcery. Well, he actually went Ring of Teacher first, but try to get that Ring of Sorcery ASAP as well. Eventually go to this bottom lane and make a push out of it or something like that, or even set up a gank, of course, on a Zephyr. Could be pretty effective here for the Hellborn side in terms of making a positive here. Because, again, I really think just the almost kind of an inexperience is definitely showing here for Team Sozo, which is, again, this decision-making here in the laning phase. We do have another vote to pause. That's, I believe, the third vote to pause here from our Legion side, at least. So they should now actually be out of pauses here for
yep.
Domain of Pain, so I need to be careful on that. Not to just use those sporadically, but I'm sure they have good reasons. It's not like they're just randomly using them. But yeah, it's, again, all across the board, it's two opposite stories. You got Domain of Pain on one hand, looking very good. You have Bubbles, by the way, JetBenz. He had a very good time here, of course, and I'm sure he played it great, but also because of all the constant swapping around earlier on. He's 33-7. He's a top farmer at 346 gold per minute, and he's already actually another 1,200-plus gold saved up even, so on top of the bottle he already has. So yeah, he is looking good. And then you have Gravekeeper, Cheese Helmet, 300 GPM, actually. Interesting
yeah.
to see how he builds both in skills and items here.
Well, just look at you have four members on the Legion team that are all farming higher than any other person on that Hellborn team. Look at that. 24 CS, 24, 25, 0, 33, 28.
Oh, when
Hellborn
team,
21, 10, 10, 1, 13.
Jeez.
It's pretty ridiculous.
That is, yeah. You wouldn't really expect to see that, so... Again, Domain of Pain, obviously, they are a dominant team by all means, and this is a team that deserves to be even in the Diamond Division. But, again, it's one thing to be just being outplayed, but it's another thing to just make poor decisions yourself, and especially going into laning phase. But, kind of just continue to harp on it. I don't want to keep on going in too much, but
let's get it on.
The pause and whatnot, I guess it's just
like,
not
I
too
think
much else to talk about.
I think the Hellborn team's draft is... awesome. Like,
yeah.
If I was to look at it, like at a post-game match stats and I see these heroes, I'm like, what the hell? How the hell did they get Keeper, Wild Soul, Moon Queen, Pebbles? Like, that's ridiculous, but they're just not playing it optimally. And, yeah. Well, we'll have to wait and see how the game progresses. It's a little passive so far with lane switch-ups and whatnot, but like I said, I expect there to be a Beast Heart. Yeah, there is a Beast Heart on the courier for Zephyr. He is level 6, I should say, now, and he's going to withstand the burst. Mm. Any kind of burst. And actually, here's some aggression onto Pebbles right now. The stun actually does hit him. And there's no boots up on the Zephyr just yet, so not a very smart usage of the ultimate there I mean, you should know, really, that you're not going to get the kill. The smart thing to do, which is save it and look for maybe a counter initiation. In the meantime, we do have a Keeper of the Forest sitting behind now. He's level 6. They might be able to do something once Pebble's combo is back up again. But he won't have it because he's out of mana.
Yeah, I was going to say, you talked about he might have wanted to save it for the counter initiation. I was going to say, speaking of that, initiation's coming in right here. In fact, Keeper of the Forest, he still wants to try to, but as you mentioned, Pebbles doesn't have enough for a combo. It is getting close, but he just barely doesn't have enough for a combo just yet. And maybe they at least want to wait for that. But Keeper of the Forest keeps going a little bit back and forth. Zephyr doesn't have that Typhoon, of course. And we could possibly be seeing a Bloodlust kill coming out right here. Nice Gust coming out. Actually, there's a Root finally coming out. In comes Pebbles. There's a Stalagmites. He does have a Chuck as well. And Zephyr. Oh, my God. Zephyr is going to barely not live. Okay, wow. I thought he was actually going to get away there for a second. But that bought enough time, if anything, for Jeppins to pick up a Bloodlust kill up here at the top. And as they dove big time, all four of them actually, diving big time on a Wild Soul up here at the top lane. So,
yeah.
Despite Zephyr still dying, he bought enough time to actually at least get a see in the Bloodlust kill.
Yeah, and you see right there just how tanky he is. Then they do get a tower off of that as well. Can Hellborn get a tower down here? Probably not. Now, Zephyr's TPing back in here. She doesn't have tornadoes or anything up like that, but it's pretty damn tanky. He also has Mystic Vestments now, and just a little bit under 1,000 HP, but top lane, yeah, Jeppin did pick up a, wow, this is a game of pauses.
Jeez,
as
yeah.
Actually, the Legion asked the Hellborn team to pause because they're out of pauses.
Yeah, their fourth pause here already, so clearly something's just problems all across the board from starting this game at the last second to random issues between multiple players apparently just popping up here. So going to time out right there, and hopefully Jeppin's returns here shortly and can resume on with what is game number one here. Of course, in the Gold Division matchup, this is the Winner's Bracket semifinals from the Gold Division for cycle number three. But yeah, Sozo down here at the bottom lane. They are going to try to pressure this bottom tower, as you're mentioning. But Zephyr here, very tanky, as he's already showing, and especially without something like a Root for that threat, probably not going to get it in the end, especially if the Legion team wants to get some Homecoming Stone portage. They do have Gravekeeper with a Homecoming Stone. Actually has Ghost Marchers as well. Looks like he is mind. He disconnected while reconnecting, so unfortunate there. And wait for that clock to come back up. Reconnect back in here. There was that other match actually going on, too. The Shit Happens versus the From Another Dimension. I don't know if I have actually any of them on my friends list. At the top of my head, doesn't look like it. Not exactly sure on their player names either, so. Actually, isn't. No, he's not. Actually, it was. Yeah, it's Jolim is part of the team, yeah.
Of which team?
He's part of Shit Happens. I totally did not mean to do that. just have to show everyone my Facebook. There we go. Okay, yeah. There's Jolim. Let's see. This is the other Winner's Bracket semifinal matchup. You have Shit Happens versus DMSN. Looks like actually Shit Happens is in the lead. 5-2 hero kills. They actually have a Moon Queen. Wow, yeah, level 15 Moon Queen way above everyone else. Got the Jirazaya in there as well.
On the same team?
Strong lineup, yeah. Jirazaya, Moon Queen, Tempest, Engineer, Pebbles.
What the?
Yeah, I mean DMSN's team is actually not too bad. Keeper, Phage, Draconis, Aluna, Legionnaire, so.
Yeah, I guess.
But yeah, it seems like it's pretty powerful for Sozo. Or, wow, not Sozo, for Shit Happens. Speaking of Sozo, again, things not going. Okay, while we're sitting more of a pause here, kind of breaking down the situation, I really think, as early on as it still is, this is a case of the inexperience for Sozo when it comes to laning phase, where it's that, again, that intimidation factor. You see your Moon Queen up top. She's in a case of basically almost even a 1v3 lane. You panic a little bit. You're like, well, we want to get her farm because she's a hard carry, so let's kind of send her mid. But obviously, even earlier on, there was a lot of indecision there. She kept going mid, kept going back top, going mid, going top.
Yeah.
Then finally, they allowed her to go mid, and then Pebbles went top. And it's like, what do you stress all the time? If anything, make sure your Pebbles absolutely gets farm. With that swap, I mean, you basically said, we want to give up farm on Pebbles to try to have a start for Moon Queen. It's like when you're in the heat of the moment, when you're in the tournament game, you know, you may not be thinking like that, but you know, hopefully for their sake, if anything, whether it's going back to this cast or just looking at it themselves, it's like, okay, yeah, we actually did make a mistake there. Got to be a little bit more decisive early on as far as your decision, and just stick with it, because all this roaming around and switching up lanes here earlier on, it'll just hinder your experience big time, and especially against a quality team like Dominic Payne. So.
Yeah, and I think that's totally right. And on top of that, too, just the knowledge of knowing which heroes you need to have farm on the most early on and which heroes can recover later. Like, you're thinking, oh my god, our Moon Queen, she's so awesome if she gets a lot of farm. Like, just get her the easy lane, get her the easiest lane possible and farm. Yeah, that's true. She does need farm, and she will carry you to victory once she gets that farm, but she can get her farm somewhere else. And but Pebbles, later on, he tapers off. You need him to be a snowball type of hero, like Gauntlet or something like that.
Yeah.
And he needs the priority, not Moon Queen. So it's having that knowledge, too, on top of just even if they did, you know, swap it around, like you mentioned, they just waited too long. And they kept going back and forth. If they made a decision right there, swap, and then just, you know, stuck with it, then, yeah, it would have been bad, you know, sending your Moon Queen and kind of hindering the farm on Pebbles. But at least they would have done something fast. But yeah. The way that they did it, though, it was just too much swapping around and not
awkward.
Enough decision-making.
Yeah, and, well, showing all across the board. I mean, we're tied at one hero kill apiece, so it's not like Domain of Pain's been going around picking up kills left and right and giving them this huge lead. But despite it being one hero kill apiece, I mean, you look at the gold per minute chart, so much better for Legion team right now. You have a 3,100 gold overall lead coming out for Domain of Pain just over after 7 minutes here. So, yeah, I mean, there's only so much breaking down you can do of a game that's only 7 minutes in at the same time. So, again, trying to do our best here as we are sitting in a pause, unfortunately. At this rate, if it does keep up here a little bit longer, I mean, I honestly think we could just jump into the other series and look to cover that one. If it might be finished. Never mind, that game's finished.
Well, there you go.
It looks like Shit Happens did win that game number one. So, well, I mean, I'll double check that real quickly, but I assume that they did win that game number one. Where would it be? Of course, it doesn't show up. Let's try you. Yeah, it's kind of shitty how you have to look at Haunter matches. It doesn't actually show up on the actual list. You have to try to find it over here. Okay, yeah. So, yep, they ended up winning on one team. Joel M, 620 gold per minute on Moon Queen.
There you
not
go.
Too bad. All right, looks like Joel, or not Joel M, Jeppins is back in here.
Speaking of Jeppins, oh my god, he has so much farm.
Yeah, he's up there, man.
He's at 2,500 saved up.
He's actually at the side shop right now, I believe. He's right, purchased a portal key.
I mean, that'd be pretty silly.
Four boots.
Okay, yeah. He's going to go for the steam boots.
Yeah. At least get the little red booties. That makes sense. There you go. So, yeah, he's got the steam boots now. And while on his way to a portal key, already at 1,000 gold. Okay, he does actually finish the power supply. So, and, well, there's the Amulet of the Exile. So, he basically uses all the gold that he has. Nothing wrong with that, of course. Good build-up items. And working on towards getting the portal key, I'm sure, shortly, though. But anyways, back to this game. So now that we're resumed, we do have Domain of Pain three-man push up here. You do have got Gravekeeper. He is level 6, so maybe expect that ultimate to be used right here to help push a tower if they find it necessary. But for now, just putting in the auto attacks is working just fine. You have Moon Queen and Wild Soul are here to defend. Wild Soul's bear's dead, actually, so...
No, it's not.
No, okay, no, it's not. It is on cooldown, however. I saw it, and I didn't see it near him, so I was like, holy crap, but... Okay, so the bear is up, but it is on cooldown, so you need to keep that in mind.
A miss done by Pebbles, and actually he's going to get turned on by Emperor right here. Did he use the Catman nuke? I'm not exactly sure. There comes Bubbles, though. He wants to get the kill onto Pebbles, but Pebbles is sitting right here, invis next to a tree. Great job. Cheese Helmet, in the meantime, gets the kill on the Pose of Dark. Emperor does fall to Wild Soul, actually, and they're on the retreat now. Aluna will be fine for now. Bubbles is still trying to get the kill, but great invis coming out from Keeper of the Forest.
Yeah, definitely saving him. It ends up being a 1-for-1 Ophelia for Moon Queen, so I still think it's safe to save Domain and Pain coming on top there, because also the big picture when you look at it, Parakletos down here on Zephyr is just doing the Turkey Zephyr thing and just farming up the lane, pushing the tower in now. And continuing to raise that GPM up, which is now up to about 290 gold per minute. So, again, nothing too crazy by any means. But he could be finishing his time with the Black Legionnaire shortly, already with boots on top of Mystic Vestment. So, yeah, Domain of Pain still coming out pretty solid there, despite that 1-for-1 exchange. But at the same time, Sozo, you know, not a bad fight for them. They do have some good team fight presence themselves and kind of show that right there. The root wasn't even used by Keeper of the Force. So.
Nor was the Moon Queen ultimate. True. As she died. So
the Moon Finale was not activated. So they are trying to regroup here, maybe go for a counter on a Gravekeeper, but Hymer knows something's up. He's going to actually port to the middle lane here. Granted, he is very low on mana. He did also use his ultimate, by the way, in that last fight, the Zombie Apocalypse, as it's called. But obviously didn't really get too much out of it, at least in kills and whatnot. But joining the middle lane with the Luna, and maybe going to try to apply a little bit of pressure here as a result of porting to the middle lane. So 1,500 plus gold saved up. How do you like to see a Gravekeeper built? What do you think Hymer's going to go for here?
Unless you really, really need the push book, I would like to see some kind of a couple of build-up items, maybe like a Grave Locket, and then just straight Portal Key. I've said this for a long time too. It's when they were first trying to, you know, trying out Gravekeeper, they wanted to try out Gravekeeper, and my initial thought was, nah, Gravekeeper sucks. But then I was thinking, okay, if there was a way to make him work, what could you do? And I immediately thought Portal Key. Mm-hmm. And then I was thinking it could actually be very, very effective because that ultimate is so devastating. It's just a matter of getting in there and getting it like casted at the perfect area. And it is a huge area, so if you can jump in there, immediately cast it, it not only creates a lot of damage, but a lot of confusion, too, as to like how to like deal with it.
All those minions running around.
Yeah, you just kind of like run away and just kind of concede to that ultimate. So I think some kind of build-up item like Gravelock, it's just straight into a Portal Key, is the best route for him. Now, I say unless you are forced by a pushbook against a hero like, say, Pharaoh or Poliwag Priest, like then a first-item pushbook would be great. But against this team, not really that necessary, at least right now.
All right, he does have 1,800 gold saved up. Again, really only Ghost Marchers picked up. Moon Queen putting the nuke onto a Luna. Ophelia is here, though, however. And actually, Luna will just pick up the regen rune. Wing Courier coming in with a Ward of Sight, it looks like, to deliver to Fitzgate as well. Playing that Luna. So Moon Queen not going to be able to really pursue. We'll instead go back to the middle lane to farm. But Paracletus, again, still down here. He is now going to be joined by both Ophelia and Luna. And they're easily going to push in this tower. Unless we see Portons right now, this tower will fall. There we go. Legion Tower, another tower kill for them. However, the Hellborn team choosing to try to go for a counter themselves here in the middle lane. In the meantime, there's that Portal Key, by the way, picked up by Hymer, playing the Gravekeeper. So he goes straight into the Portal Key, following the Ghost Marchers.
Uh-huh.
Kind of taking your advice right there. And we'll see now if he gets that initiation with it here. As far as the ultimate goes, in fact, he is going to port in. So possible team fight could be coming up. Keeper of the Forest trying to chase on Ophelia off to the side. He does have a root, but Ophelia is just out of range. Oh, it's going to hit actually with the root. And Emperor will fall as a result. Very well played right there. Wild Soul trying to take some damage. The Gamma Champion going to nuke him, though. Great Nature's Fell coming out. Will barely keep Watts alive, but no. The Song of the Sea nuke finishing him off when it's all said and done. Meanwhile, Moon Finale going off in the background. As Moon Queen trying to live, she's going to get Nature's Veiled by her teammate once again and be fine. Zephyr in pursuit of Pebbles, though. Pebbles does not have a chuck. He has to lag. That's almost done. Gravekeeper ports in. He did use his ultimate already. Trying to chase down. The gust forward, actually. He almost helps Pebbles.
Oh,
a bit, but
nice.
No. The final auto attack hits, and Cheese Helmet gets credit for the kill right there.
Great attack walking there by Cheese Helmet. And I thought he actually could have waited one more time, one more attack from Cheese Helmet to use that gust from Paracletos. As it did push him forward, but still the extra movement speed burst that you get from those Ghost Marchers certainly helped. So great job by Cheese Helmet right there. And they're going to, as a result, push us down the tower. I do have to say, though, at the same time, that was very kind of questionable initiation by Hymer there. He actually went on to Wild Soul. He was already in his ulti form. He ulted him and tried to initiate on him, but just did very, very little damage.
Yeah.
And I think if he went on maybe a different target, it would have been a little bit more effective.
Yeah, so... you know, in the end, they come out on top, and so Domain of Pain can be happy with it again. And you see the overall gold lead now kind of expanding here, 7,600 gold lead. Obviously, even pushing the secondary tower there, no doubt helping. Keeper of the Forest being a little bit crafty. He actually comes out of the Envious, steals a creep from Ophelia, and then quickly runs away. So a little bit risky there, but in the end, he is fine. So Zephyr, of course, the Helm of the Black Legion finish. The Ghost Marchers on top of that. And that GPM is going to start raising and raising, 345 and counting. And he's a third on his team. You still have the Gravekeeper at 377. And then Jeppins remains to be the top farm in the game. On that Bubbles, 395 gold per minute, another 2,000 gold saved up. He did go the Grave Locket, but now it looks like more than likely going to go for the Portal Key here and about 50 more gold or so. In fact, there we go. He just gets enough for it. And we'll probably purchase it and deliver it right here. Make me look good, Jeppins. Never mind.
Yeah, you just want to get those extra CS, so his focus is turned to that right now. But should buy it right here. Has a double damage rune actually activated, and it's going to take this tower down very, very easily in mid.
Oh, wow, yep. Like, oh, and Vulner put it at the last second, actually. So keeper. The four is going to come to try to deny it, but no, just a little bit too late. Cheese Salmon actually comes in with a portal key, and he final auto attacks it. But there you go. There's a portal key purchase on the Bubbles as well. So now they both have portal keys. We're only just now past 14 minutes into this game. Speaking of portal key, obviously a hero that comes to mind is Pebbles. And to say the least, he hasn't had the best of games so far. Only 215 gold per minute here. He has Steam Boots and a Mystic Vestments, really. And then you even have a Wild Soul. Usually a Wild Soul we would expect to see pretty good farm, even if he happens to be in that Suicide role, which in this case he did start out in the Suicide against the Zephyr, and then, of course, eventually went top, but only farming 150 gold per minute. As he is 1-2 also, so.
Well, they made him move around, and that's going to hinder the farm of anybody, regardless of what hero you are. And even if he just sat down there, he probably would have had a lot more CS, maybe even hit like the 50, 60 CS mark, but as a result of moving around, and also because you're moving around, that means you're going to have more experience, especially on top of a good farm on the other team. And it's when it's a team that has lots of push between Zephyr and Ophelia, and also Gravekeeper can also push as well with an ultimate. Does extra damage to the towers.
Mm-hmm.
And even that the third spell, the Defiling Touch, the passive, does extra damage to the towers as well. So
yeah,
moving around all the time against this mass push team, again, not going to help your cause.
Yeah, that's very true to bring up. The Defiling Touch, the third ability, does actually attack the passive. Speaking of Gravekeeper, actually, look at this. He's stuck on a ledge right here. He portal keyed in, trying to, I think, catch Wild Soul was right there, but he gets stuck instead. he's going to have to portal key again. Yeah, that was actually pretty funny.
You can actually use direct pathing to get over stuff like that.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Oops. Well, he was able to portal key out, so he is going to be fine in the end. He does have his ultimate, as does everyone else really well. There you go. Ophelia actually using hers to heal up her minions and everyone else. This tower continuing to take a lot of damage, dropping about half life already. You see the power throw going to be used, if anything, to clean up a couple of the tree dogs there, as well as the creep wave that the Hellborn team had. Maybe wait for the next one. And then perhaps look to jump in here, or maybe just fall back if you're demanding pain. And realize that you're only 16 and a half minutes in right now. You're at a pretty comfortable spot. You don't necessarily need to push into the base. But they are going to go for it once again. At least a little bit more pressure right here. Zephyr leading the way, obviously, in those front lines. Has another 2,000 gold pulled up himself, by the way. But I thought that was a typhoon for a second. I was like, whoa, what?
Yeah.
Okay, but no, it's like a tornado being used.
There's going to be so many tornadoes.
Yeah, that's true. With the Zephyr, so it's bigger than his own cyclones.
Heroes of Oklahoma, as we see a couple tornadoes coming out.
Yeah. So the tornado chasing this Pebbles right here, and if anything, this is just a fun harassment tool here. But again, neither side really having the biggest impact here, although the Legion team, they are pressuring the tower more and more. And unless we see a jump here from the Hellborn team, it very likely could fall here. As Moon Queen is spamming those moon beams left and right. She does have a Warhammer picked up, by the way, on top of her Steam Boots. So
interesting.
Yeah, I wonder if that's going to turn into eventually the Shrunken Head, or dare I say something like a Shieldbreaker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does look like they're forcing the issue a little bit too much, but I will say they have good initiation between Bubbles and Gravekeeper, and I think sometime during that time they should have maybe just manned up and went, but that... You know, that's a very risky move, so they don't want to do that. That's why they didn't jump.
Yeah.
And they do fall back. They realize they're actually wasting a lot of time and resources in, you know, trying to kill a tower that they're just simply not going to at this time. They maybe need to look for another pickoff or a couple more big items on it, specifically Zephyr, so that they can do more damage to that tower. Or something like a barrier idol, too, on perhaps Ophelia, so that they can save the creeps from all the spam that's coming out from, you know, the, basically Pebbles, but Moon Queen's also doing a lot of damage to those creeps as well.
Mm-hmm. Now, Jeppins is just kind of sitting here. Yeah,
yep.
That's what I thought happened. He does time out, so, and they do need Sozo to pause here. And okay, there you go. They're going to pause the game. Of course, he's the one that actually disconnected earlier, so clearly having a little bit of internet troubles here, unfortunately. But he was literally just standing here for a good 10 seconds, and I'm like, yeah, he's probably DC'd. Sure enough, it happens. So again, last time he did reconnect fairly quickly. So... into the more pause we go. Now, there is only one more pause overall left, so that's another dangerous thing.
Yep.
Got to be careful about that, because it gets to a point where if he does happen to DC again, they don't have pauses. I mean, you just play on, and so you have a lead here, but that would be the worst thing to happen. So he is reconnecting, though.
And so what if Sozo needs a pause, you know? Like, what if they need a pause for one of their
it's
members?
It's not fair for them, yeah.
And, like, what if they waste their next pause on Jeppins again and someone on their team DCs? Like, that... You got to think about those kind of things.
Yeah, that is
and not unfair. To say that it's like, you know, it's it could be bad mannered, so to speak, if like they say no, we don't want to pause. But you got to think about yourself, and in a you know big match like this, and it ultimately comes down to, do we need more pauses in the game, or do we need, as casters or as spectators, someone able to pause them for them if they need it?
Yeah,
I know that's come up in the past, specifically at DreamHack. I remember there was a in the summer there was an issue where a lot of, with one of the computers where there was all pauses used, mm-hmm. and the game had to be played on.
I remember that. Yeah. Yeah, it is something that you know, kind of wonder about. If anything, just specifically for a Hauntour match, might be something pretty reasonable. But
right,
unfortunately, nothing like that just yet. So we'll see. We'll see down the line, perhaps.
Yeah, obviously it wouldn't.
You wouldn't want to do that like a normal game.
Well, I mean, yeah, but in TMMs there are no spectators, so it wouldn't be an issue.
True. Wild Soul, actually, he is going to drop right there as Bubbles finds him by himself. So speaking of Jeppins, comes back into the game and picks up a solo kill onto Wild Soul, actually. So good job by Jeppins right there. And just like that, he has another 2,300 gold saved up, 408 gold per minute. He buys one of, I'm sure, to be three Arcanas here. And, of course, that will then turn into a Hellflower. So Domain of Pain, pretty comfortable as far as falling back for now and farming it up, but they are kind of regrouping more of the top side of the map yet again, and going to possibly try to break into the base just like they did only a couple of minutes ago, or at least attempted to do a couple of minutes ago, as they got some bigger and better items, especially your Zephyr, actually finished his Shaman's Headdress here. And then you have Gravekeeper. You mentioned the tablet's good on him, but he went the Portakey first, but now he also goes the Tablet of Command, so he has both now, and has some extra utility there as a result of that pickup. So he also continues to farm very, very well at 370 GPM now.
Yep.
Again, they're going to group up, try to break into the base. We'll see. I got to assume that at least the tower is going to fall this time. Here, we'll see about the racks, though.
And no barrier idol is up, but you have like yet again another tornado coming out from the Vulture Lord, which is going to be very effective as well. And yeah, they're going to push this in. Here comes the ultimate, though.
Yeah, Keeper of the Force, a big root right there, actually. We do have Gravekeeper jumping in the background, and there's the zombie apocalypse on top of the corpse explosion, actually. And just like that, Prophet and Pebbles will fall. Keeper of the Force goes down. Moon Queen just falls back. He did Moon Finale, but unfortunately doesn't get any kills out of it. We do see Wild Soul getting gusted in. Hatcher coming out for Paracletos, playing that Zephyr. And just like that, in a blink of an eye, Domain of Pain is going to just swamp through, getting all those kills. They're going to take out both of the racks. We are just now passing 20 and a half minutes into this game, and Domain of Pain has already done so much as far as pressure. Up to now, 17,000 gold lead and an 8,800 experience lead here.
Yeah, they have actually some really strong ultimates on their team. Like, you know, one of the things that really makes Gravekeeper viable, and in fact, I will go out and say, and probably the one thing that makes him viable, is his ultimate. It is so damn strong. Actually, there he is, the vote to concede, and GG's coming out. And Domain of Pain will take out game, or will take game one over Team Sozo in the gold division here.
Yeah, it's clearly that was just getting definitely starting to get a little bit out of hand for Sozo. And well, again, not to keep beating it, but simply put, it just goes back to laning phase. I think it's not that necessarily Domain of Pain outplayed them earlier on. At least it really just was indecision from Sozo. You know, even if like you put it, if you are gonna switch, just switch, do it right away, and then be done with it. There was indecision there. They were completely unsure of what exactly to do, and all the heroes ended up being completely different lanes. You know, a couple minutes into the game after that. So
I mean, how many times have we seen Moon Queen go back to mid, go top, go mid, go top, go mid, go top? It was like, you know, a good four or five times, and
oops. Yeah, didn't work out too well. So with that said, once again, that is game number one. Hopefully going to game two at the very least, we can go a fluid game here.
Yeah.
Not have to deal with all those delays, but maybe I just jinxed us at the same time. So anyways, game number two will be coming up here shortly. As always, we're going to take a quick break here, and we'll be right back. So Domain of Pain, taking on Team Please. Stay tuned. Game two coming up next.